Thank you for downloading this Council on Foreign Relations video. CFR is an independent national membership organization and nonpartisan research center. For more information, please visit us online at cfr.org.
Good evening. We do not usually have a double introduction, but it will be a short one. But because of the interest in this evening's speaker, we are going to depart a little bit from the usual format. My name is John Bellinger. I am an adjunct senior fellow in international and national security law here at the Council on Foreign Relations. And I want to welcome you all here to tonight's discussion with the ICC prosecutor, Luis Moreno-Ocampo. Tonight is the inaugural event of a new series of events in a Council on Foreign Relations program on international justice that is being directed by me and Matthew Waxman of Columbia University. And we have got a generous grant from the MacArthur Foundation to support this. We expect over the next 2 years to have a series of events focusing on the international criminal tribunals and issues like universal jurisdiction. And we also hope to produce very quickly a council special report on the U.S. negotiating role as we go into the Kampala Review Conference for the ICC. This is the 10th anniversary of the International Criminal Court, and there is a review conference in May and June of this year, so we will be producing, we hope, in fairly short order, a special report on how the U.S. should approach that. My friend Judge Stephen Schwebel is going to introduce the prosecutor in just a moment. Most of you know Steve, but for the few of you who don't, I have to say Steve is one of the most respected international lawyers and jurists in the world. I am particularly proud of the fact that Steve started in the legal advisor's office, where he worked for many years and rose to be deputy legal advisor. In 1981, he was nominated and elected to be the U.S. judge on the International Court of Justice in The Hague, where he served for 19 years, including from 1997 to 2000 as the president or the chief justice of the International Court of Justice. So we're very honored to have him here tonight. I have to say, given the venue, most important, though, Steve has been a member of the Council on Foreign Relations for 54 years, since 1956. Judge Schwebel.
Thank you so much, John, for emphasizing how old I am. It's a great pleasure to welcome you to this meeting of the Council on Foreign Relations. Members of the Council from around the world, around the nation and the world, are participating in this meeting via teleconference. Please, before we begin, turn off your cell phones, BlackBerries, and the like to avoid interference with the sound system. This meeting is on the record, and there are some guests present as well as members of the council. We're fortunate to have a dialogue this evening with Mr. Luis Moreno-Ocampo, who is the first prosecutor of the International Criminal Court. Before his election by the Assembly of States Parties to the Rome Statute as prosecutor, Mr. Moreno-Ocampo had a most distinguished and courageous record as a prosecutor in Argentina, notably as prosecutor of Argentine generals who were in control of the Argentine state for some years and who prosecuted the so-called dirty war. Mr. Moreno-Ocampo, first of all, will make some remarks about the International Criminal Court and his role as prosecutor in it. Then I'll ask him a few questions, and then we'll move to questions from the audience. Mr. Moreno-Ocampo, please.
Thank you. Thank you very much. I prepared a long speech, so you have the papers. You can read it. I was receiving clear instructions I should not read. And my idea to summarize the idea, then we can discuss. I feel I'd like to present three ideas here. Or basically one idea is the idea is how to prevent those crimes that we thought over and over will never happen again, only to see they occur again and again before our eyes. Genocide, crimes against humanity, and war crimes. These are my crimes. And what I'd like to discuss with you is something new here, and it's called international legal institutions who are trying to deal with the problem. And for me, it's interesting because in this country, it's difficult to believe that you will be protected from outside for legal institutions, but not the same for other countries. And that's what I'd like to present to you. Because basically, this is an idea promoted by three regions, Europe, Africa, and South America. And the common ground is that all these regions suffer these massive crimes. And they learn that no country can control these crimes alone. Europe suffered in the Nazi regime and the Balkans. South America and Africa suffered during the Cold War. And lastly, I will mention the genocide, Rwanda genocide. But it's interesting, today I was talking with a friend of mine who's an international lawyer and asked him, what do you know about the Congo Wars? He had no idea that existing Congo Wars. And in the Congo Wars, 4 million people die. And it's the consequence of Rwanda genocide, as you know, because the roots are people moved from Rwanda to Congo, and then the Congo was destabilized, and 4 million people died. 16 countries were involved in these two wars. And that's what they learned. They learned that it's not possible to control these massive atrocities alone. And there are other countries from other regions who also understand this idea, like I would say Canada, Mexico, Australia, New Zealand, Japan and South Korea, Jordan and Afghanistan. All these are the state parties. So this is their idea. And to emphasize this idea, how the law is protecting them, I'd like to quote a Costa Rica ambassador, because we had a meeting with him a month ago at Harvard. And then he was explaining why Costa Rica was so active in Darfur case during Costa Rica's tenure in the Security Council. And Costa Rica explained, it's about national interest. For Costa Rica, enforce and promote international law to protect countries is in the national interest, and it's beyond. Because they say, there are 26 countries in the world with no army, and Costa Rica is the biggest. So they have the responsibility to lead. Exactly. If you're Costa Rica, no army, yes, you are leading in the idea to use the law to protect themselves. And so for them, it's a matter of domestic security. It's not a principle. For Canada, it's a principle. For Costa Rica, it's different. And OK, another example I quoted in my paper is Liechtenstein, who is Liechtenstein is today, the ambassador, Christian Benavesser, is the UN ambassador for Liechtenstein. He's ambassador of Liechtenstein at UN in New York, and is the current president of the Assembly to take part of the Rome Statute. So Liechtenstein is our leader. And he say, state parties are under the protection of the court. That's the concept. And this is a cornerstone of the international criminal justice system they develop, the rule of law as the protection. This is, for me, the first idea, and the idea I'm not sure if I can convey to you, and if you in this country can understand this idea, but that's what these 100 states are thinking, protect themselves. Dico's idea in the paper in 1998, they adopted. And in 2003, they gave me the responsibility to put this idea in motion. And the mission is defined by the statute. My mission is to end impunity for these crimes in order to contribute to the prevention of future crimes. So the goal is prevention here. That is the mission. And I have three different types of activities. My mandate is to select the situation to investigate. And this is pretty unusual because in Yugoslavia, in Nuremberg, in Rwanda, the state defined where to investigate. Here, I can select the situation. And that was a big issue in Rome. Then I had to investigate, I had to prosecute the cases. In the paper, you will see the criteria established by the statute. I have to first assess jurisdiction. So I have jurisdiction according with the treaty when the crimes are committed by nationals of state parties or in the territory of state parties. And therefore, Sri Lanka, Iraq, Lebanon, Burma, Zimbabwe, Nepal, or Somalia are not state parties. Whatever crimes are committed there, I could not be involved without Security Council referral, because they are not state parties. Second, I have temporal jurisdiction in crimes committed after July 1st, 2002. Third, subject matter jurisdiction is crimes against humanity, war crimes, and genocide. For instance, as example, in Venezuela, we reject Venezuela because whatever you think about Venezuela, these crimes are not committed there. Fourth, and this is important to understand, my first duty is not to investigate when the national states are conducting investigation. I have to respect genuine national investigation because that is the interesting model developed in Rome. It's a model based on coalition of states who are committed to prosecute themselves the case, but they accept that if they don't do it, I will do it. The ICC will do it. So my first duty is to respect what they are doing. So I had to assess if there are national proceedings. And Colombia, you will see in the paper, is the best example of a case in which there are crimes allegedly under my jurisdiction. However, because they are conducting national investigation, I should not interfere there as soon as they are doing the cases. Then another requisite I had to respect is a threshold of gravity. Because we have crimes against humanity and genocide normally are massive crimes, and war crimes, we have to work on them, in particular where they are committed as part of a plan or a policy or as part of a large-scale commission. Therefore, we assess the existence of crimes committed by national state parties in Iraq, because I had jurisdiction on them. We found, in three different cases, we found tortures and willful killings. But we decided we should not intervene because were isolated crimes not committed as a policy. Therefore, it's an example of what we cannot do. And the sixth requisite is something very vague. The status say I have the authority to decide not to proceed with an investigation or prosecution if it is not in the interest of justice. And we are trying to refine what is justice, but what's clear for us is interest of justice is not the interest of peace or interest of security. That's how the Security Council matters. I could not replace Security Council, and for me it's very important to keep my judicial work, not be involved in political work. It's interesting because the president of the court say the court is a judicial institution operating in a highly political environment. That's our life. And what I do, I respect my legal limit, but in particular, my policy is to not to stretch the interpretation of the law. What I do to facilitate the political actor is to inform them in advance what I will do, hoping that they will take this in consideration. Not always happen. When I request the arrest warrant of President Bashir, one ambassador in the UN told me, "Prosecutor, how you can do Bashir without informing us in advance?" And I said, "I'm sorry, but for the last year, I came here in 6 months. I was telling you I will prosecute the person who protected the minister. How many people can protect the minister? How many people can order the minister? That's what I say." And the ambassador told me, Yeah, you say that, But we did not believe you will do it. So my capacity to inform in advance is not working very well, and that's something, one of the reasons I'm here is trying to understand better how to communicate with this diplomatic environment, who is crucial for me. Because basically, at the end of the day, the impact of my cases will be defined by them, not by me. But so it's not easy to explain to them what we will do. In addition to these possibilities, I mentioned the Security Council can refer to me case, any case in the world. So they can give me a case as an ad hoc basis, as they did in Darfur. And a state can accept jurisdiction for a case, for a situation. And that's what Palestine is attempting. So these are the rules of selection of situations. So basically, we're working in cases in Congo, Uganda, Central African Republic, Darfur, and now we're requesting the judge's authorization to start an investigation into Kenya. We have four prisoners in jail. The trials are now moving. And in addition, we are assessing if we have jurisdiction in different situations in the world, including Colombia, Cote d'Ivoire, Afghanistan, Guinea. We have this Palestine request for Palestine, and that's it. And Georgia. So that's my last point. This is what we are doing. My last point. I don't know how to do this short, because basically what I'd like to explain to you is, yes, criminal lawyers focus on what happened inside the court. And of course, we have to be perfect in court. And you will see some examples of what we do. We almost, for different reasons, we were going to lose the first case the court was trying to do, because I had a duty to respect confidentiality, and then when the organization provided to me information, I had to respect confidentiality, but also I had to disclose information with material for defense. And I told the judges, look, I have this information I cannot disclose, but could be material for the defense. They just say, okay, show it to us. I cannot do it because the rules say I cannot do it. So the judges say, okay, prosecutor, but then we stay the proceedings and we free Lubanga. And I say, okay, do it. So basically, I think it's a good example how the court was ready to lose the first case, but not to compromise in our legal duties. I, in my legal duty, to respect confidentiality and respect the right of the defense to see the material, but were a contradiction. And the judges in the respect for fair trial. And I think in the long term, this is exactly what had to happen, because the court, to be respected, should be a serious court. However, my point is, even with the best court in the world, the issue is not what the court is doing. The issue is how the court will impact. And the impact is not just about ourselves. I mentioned here, at Harvard, they normally, we talk about the shadow of the court. And this is based on an idea of a Professor Manuki, who developed a paper years ago talking about something normal, family courts who are deciding on divorces. But then the lawyers use the same rules to make divorces without the judge's involvement. And the idea was, okay, these people are working under the shadow of the court. And at the end of the day, this is very important. In particular, in my court, who would do two or three cases in the next 3 years, the shadow, who could be global, is the most important part. Because that was the concept. The concept is because the system is based on the idea that the national court will do it. Few cases in The Hague could have a tremendous impact, not just for the court, for other actors. And that's the point I was trying to make. First, political leaders. Political leaders are critically important here, in particular when we are prosecuting people like President Bashir. Because the other leader had to exclude Bashir. And interestingly, in this case, even Bashir was trying to collect support, because that's what the indictment against him produced, that he had to collect support for him. And he was campaigning. However, South Africa, for instance, and this is very remarkable, told him, we invite you for the opening ceremony of inauguration of President Zuma, but if you come here, you will be arrested. Mm-hmm. And then Uganda, Nigeria, Venezuela, even Turkey say that. Sarkozy canceled an Arab-French meeting because President Bashir will be going to be there. So President Lula, President Kirchner from Argentina refused to meet him in this Arab South America summit. So there are different indicia that the leaders are taking this in consideration. And the Guinea case, another example I mentioned in my paper, showing how the impact, the preventative impact we have on the leaders of Guinea, but also how even Morocco was afraid not to appear protecting a war criminal. So this is happening well. The second idea working well is armies. Armies all over the world are adjusting the standards, the training, and the rules of engagement to the ICC. And that, for me, is the perfect impact, because that's the way to ensure that the use of the force will be in accordance with the rules. And that is the way to change the use of violence. This is happening. The third point is mediators. This is the pen. So negotiators are critically important, because at the end of the day, they have to find solution or try to find solution for the problems. I have a good example with Kofi Annan in Kenya, managing very well. He helped to stop violence during the post-election, but also he keep working and always promising justice had to be done. In other cases, you see examples, for instance, when we prosecuted, in the first case of Darfur, we prosecuted Mr. Haroon, and basically the arrest warrant was ignored and was neither good for the mediation nor for justice. Nothing happened. The situation was worse. So I found this area of negotiation is an area who has to be developed. And maybe that's why I like to give the message clear here. We have a very sophisticated army rules. Armies are very sophisticated, as you know. They have very strict rules on collateral damage, on everything. Judges and prosecutors are complicated because we have all these evidence rules, and suddenly the negotiation became so basic and primitive. I have information we cannot discuss now. But it's really, normal negotiators don't know exactly what happened there. They have not enough information. They are not well trained. And this is catastrophic. Of course, when you have Kofi Annan, or I would say Richard Williamson, things work well. But it's not yet a clear rules and protocols that what they should do, what they should not do. One ambassador, when I explained this idea, you can do much better. One ambassador in New York told me, it's a problem for us because we have two tactics, bombing or appeasing, nothing. So when they are not doing what we want, we threat with the bombing. As soon they accept whatever we want, they are appeasing. So nothing between bombing or nothing. And that's the problem for us. I think that is something to be developed. And my last 2 points are about victims who are participating with us, and even as a witness, they're exposing themselves, and citizens. And I will say, we need citizens, because if not, the political leader will not take this in consideration. So political leaders need support to take the different decisions they have to take. And therefore, we need citizens. I am quote the example of Invisible Children. I don't know if you know this group. It's an amazing group. There's basically 20-year-old boys from San Diego who were studying filmmaking. And they went to Uganda. They filmed. They saw these children walking each night to be protected. They filmed them, and they start to show the movie here, and they develop a network of thousands of young people from the US supporting this, developing schools in Uganda, and now they are promoting passing a law in the Congress to request the arrest of Joseph Kony. So, and this is 3 kids, today they're 27. They're 3 young kids from San Diego who built this institution called Invisible Children, who are promoting this global citizen idea. So that's political leaders, armies, negotiators, victims, and citizens. That's what we need to promote. And that is the opportunity. So let me conclude with the non-party like US. What I saw in my 6-year tenure is more and more non-state parties are cooperating with us. Russia was providing to us 3,000 communications on crimes committed in Georgia. China say they are a non-state party partner. Egypt, Qatar are working very well with us. And the U.S. also was very supportive. Okay, John Belichick will explain much better than me what the U.S. is doing and was doing. But I would say U.S. adopted positive, after 2005, adopted policy of positive engagement, supporting some of our cases, in particular Uganda, and I would say a lot Darfur. And now they are supporting a lot in Kenya also. And I think that is the way to keep working together. No, the court has to keep doing legal work, but we need to increase the support of these different actors. And that would be at least a way to build a system in which in Huntington State will be not these massive crimes. And that is a good beginning, because that's for me the idea. I see U.S. is normally saying that this country feel that you need efficient multilateral organizations. And you feel sometimes that when you are not leading, the other countries are doing nothing. Okay, this is a case in which 110 states are doing something. And you have to decide what to do with this effort. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much. Mr. Moreno-Ocampo, under the Rome Statute, the prosecutor acts independently and cannot seek or receive instructions from any external source. Is it appropriate for the prosecutor, before reaching a decision to prosecute, to consult with governments and UN officials about the possible diplomatic impact of bringing a prosecution?
Let me answer with my story. When I arrived to The Hague, everyone was asking me to intervene in Iraq because it was a similar time. But Iraq is not a party, the U.S. is not a party, so I could do nothing. So I was thinking, okay, I would dismiss this, I would manage expectation, clearly, but at the same time, I had to choose a case. So we look, the worst cases were Colombia and Congo. But in Colombia, there were national prosecutions, nothing in Congo. So we said, it's Congo. And then I said, I have an international relations advisor, and I asked her, okay, how to start a case in Congo supported by states? And she said, okay, what you got to do is go to do consultations with different diplomats and different leaders, and then you get support, and then you start with the support. I say, okay, but what's happening if they don't support us? They say no. Oh, if they say no, you cannot do it. So I say, okay, but we are prosecutors. We cannot give the decision to others. So from those days, we started this method to be informed in advance what we will do and then do it. So the first decision is judicial. This is the case, what to do, how to select the case. We inform, hoping that they will follow. And that sometimes they follow, sometimes it's more difficult, but at the end they are moving. But basically, yes, I cannot consult, because then I became a politician. Yeah. And then sometimes it will be hard, sometimes not, but that's my job. So that the answer is that. So what to do, the decision is judicial, and then inform, and try to get support.
Now, one hears that there's been some grumbling in African circles that the ICC has concentrated unduly on Africa. Do you have any comment on that?
Yeah, many. Now, first, I think it's a measure of success. We produce fear. I like that. Yeah, we are producing fear that if you commit this crime, you will be prosecuted. That's a good idea. And in fact, you see, there are 30 African state parties. None of them leave the court. And as I say, South Africa clearly say, Bashir, you come here, you'll be arrested. So they are not the leader of the state party who are saying that. There are others saying that. And in fact, it's Bashir who is promoting this idea. So basically, it's propaganda. Interestingly, if you remember when Rwanda happened, in Africa, people were complaining that why they are not interested in the African people killed, and you are working on Yugoslavia, then the UN had to create the Rwanda Tribunal. In my case, I care about African victims, basically, that's the point. Yes, Bashir is African, but he's killing millions, thousands of African people. His victims are African. So we have to choose a side. I'm the prosecutor, my side are the victims.
Now, under the statute, the crime of aggression is within the jurisdiction of the ICC, but it hasn't been actively so pending agreement on a definition. Is there anything you can say about the desirability or undesirability of the court taking on prosecutions for aggression?
No, I am the prosecutor. You pass, you got the law. I can, no, it's not my, I have so many problems, I'm not focusing on the problems who are not my problem. This is not my problem.
What? I noted in the text of your speech that there's some 800 staff between the registry and the prosecutor's office. That's about 20 times the number of staff of the International Court of Justice. What are so many people doing?
Oh, my goodness. We are like a Boston prosecutor office, okay? We are like a Boston prosecutor office. I have 150 investigators to investigate all my cases. I have around 40 lawyers going to different cases in court. I have around 30 lawyers working international cooperation. Then the registry has they had to run a prison. They had to run 6 field offices. They had to run the witness protection system. They had to run the office for the lawyers, for the public, not the public, the lawyer for the defense. The victims have lawyers too, legal representatives. So they are a different department. They are victims, it's an area to receive the victims who want compensation. It's the court service system. You have translations. We have to translate French, English, Lingala, Swahili, and different languages. Just in Darfur, there are 4 languages. So it's a complex operation.
That one. It is complex.
Yes. In ICJ, yeah, it's fine because you receive the, you have to do nothing. You just receive and read and decide. Here, we have to, I have to produce the cases.
Right.
And we are working in a difficult environment. But our size is the Boston Prosecutor Office. But they have the FBI, who's not in the budget. I have to do the case myself. So we are very cheap.
Well, let's open open things up now to questions from the audience. The gentleman just here, please. Please state your name and affiliation and speak into the microphone which is being brought to you.
Thank you. My name is Travis Atkins. I'm with the International Foundation for Electoral Systems. And also I served as a humanitarian worker, aid worker in Darfur 2004 and 2005, so also a witness to the atrocities there. So my question for you, Mr. Moreno-Ocampo, is that given the overwhelming amounts of evidence of systemized attacks, the use of rape as a weapon of war, racialized attitudes and targeted towards specific ethnic groups, why do you think it's been so difficult to meet the threshold of proving intent when it comes to charges of genocide, and also given the news of yesterday's lowering of the threshold in terms of indictments versus prosecution?
Okay, the first, the judges approve the charge of extermination as a crime against humanity. So what happened in the camps is contemplated as a crime of extermination. The issue they say was not enough evidence about the targeting of the specific groups, that is genocide. They use a standard. In my application, we say we have so much evidence that is the only possible inference, so we are beyond doubts. And they say, no, it's not true. There are other inference possibles, and then they dismiss our request. But the problem is we say this beyond doubt is for the conviction. We are requesting a writ warrant, and the standard is reasonable basis to believe, and we are far beyond that. So the judges basically use the standard of conviction for the standard of a writ warrant. And that was yesterday the appeal chamber rectified. So it was a legal discussion, and then we won the discussion. Now we are going back. And I agree with you, it's a genocide, and I think we'll get it.
Yes, please.
Eugene Moranz with the law firm of Cary Gottlieb. Have you noticed at all any evidence of deterrent effect of potential prosecution before your court? Maybe that's a silly question under all the circumstances, but in the criminal justice system, deterrence is one of the elements that helps succeed.
Yes. No, okay, I have many stories. It's very difficult to show causal relation because, for instance, in the Joseph Kony case, because the Sudan was involved in the Joseph Kony attacks, they were trying to be sure we are not prosecuting them. So they signed an agreement with us saying that they will arrest Joseph Kony and they will conduct investigation against themselves. As a consequence of this agreement, Joseph Kony had to leave. He left Sudan and moved to Congo. And basically, the Ugandan crime stopped in Uganda. So this is something you can see. And I can show you a graph. The killings were reducing in all our cases. Since we started to work, the killing were reduced. The problem is in Darfur, the displacement is huge, and it's a different type of crime. And the problem in Joseph Kony case, the killing were reducing in Uganda, but now last year he was killing people in Congo. So at the end of the day, that's why we need to arrest him. It's not enough. But I can mention different stories. For instance, the Colombia is clear. The paramilitary were saying they like to be involved in the national system because they don't like to face ICC. And in Somalia, I have many stories about in Somalia, the warlords were threatening each other to denounce their cases before the ICC. And interestingly, that's why for me the shadow idea, the impact is so important. The UN Special Representative for Child Soldiers say she went to Nepal, and she found that in Nepal, they release all the child soldiers as a consequence of the Lubanga trial, who is in Congo. And Nepal even is not a state party. So we are collecting these type of stories. So I have these stories. I have no numbers for an economic mind. I have no numbers to show. I have some stories. I think, yes. Of course, and that's the point. If we arrest Joseph Kony, the terrorism will increase. If President Bashir is isolated and arrested, will increase. That's why the impact is not just about the court. It's about the system working in the shadow of the court.
Professor, please.
No. How are you?
Doug Castle from Notre Dame. You have mentioned both President Bashir and Joseph Kony, both of whom are among the most prominent, perhaps the most prominent people indicted but not arrested.
Yeah.
My question to you, and perhaps you can't comment on it, but if you can, do you have any requests or suggestions that you would like to make to the diplomatic community and the powers that have the military forces necessary as to what should be done in regard to arresting either or both of them? Thank you.
Yeah. They're different because in the case of Joseph Kony, what we need is a special force operation. Legally, it's perfect. Politically, it's perfect. Everyone is in agreement. But we have no one providing special forces to do it. Uganda is the only country in the world who is willing to attempt to do it, but they are planning normal war operations. And they bomb the camps first, and they attack with like an army, and then Kony always escape. And then if they kill 300 soldiers, he does not care because our child's kids abducted, so he go and abduct more. So we need to change the approach, and yes, we need special forces. I publicly can say that, and I hope countries who have special forces can devote one operation for this. We'll save thousands of lives. One of my problems is working in Africa, in Georgia. There are 300, the crimes in Georgia, alleged crimes in Georgia, the worst is 30,000 people displaced. Joseph Kony himself, in the last year, displaced 280,000 people just in Congo and killed 1,200 people. I have him indicted. I should not do a second case, but no one knows the crimes he's committed here in Congo. So, yes, we need desperately special forces to arrest Joseph Kony. President Bashir is different because I don't believe he should be arrested military. It's a political process, no? I think I had a discussion with China ambassador last time. I was telling him, because I studied a lot the principle of China, and China paid particular attention to the national sovereignty. concept. So I told Ambassador, my approach is Chinese. Why you say that? Because see Bashir, explain to me. We request the arrest warrant against President Bashir, and we request the Sudan to arrest President Bashir. So we absolutely respect national sovereignty. We respect the national country to arrest his own president, its own president. So that's what we are thinking. I think it's a matter of what's happening with Nixon here in a different type of crime. You need a political control, and then he will be, he cannot be a fugitive president. In fact, because he needs protection. So he basically cannot be the president of the country, but will take time. So we need two different types of approach. Special forces for Joseph Kony, because it's legally totally perfect and politically okay. A political strategy for President Bashir.
The gentleman over there, please.
I'm Perfil Argentina. In Argentina, 23 years ago, when you were prosecuting the military junta, there was a famous word there that we used to use called obediencia debida. That means that the corps were following orders from top.
Yeah.
So there was a moment that there was a limit, and maybe you can explain much better than me, probably, that you cannot follow more in the lower ranks because they said that they were following orders.
Yeah.
How this apply to all the cases that you are following?
Since Nuremberg, the obedience is not accepted as excuse. And Argentina was the wrong title. The Supreme Court says it's just a partial amnesty, basically. In our court, what we do is, because I had to select a few cases, I focus on the most responsible people. But we are not providing impunity for the others because the court is complementary. So after we do the top, after, for instance, now with President Becky. President Becky is promoting the idea to do more cases in Sudan. Perfect. We do President Bashir, Nitin Haroon, Ali Kushib, the rest, always will do it. So we focus in few cases, top people, because that will increase the deterrence impact, and the national citizens should do it after. And Argentina is a good example, because 30 years after, it's still judges doing cases in Argentina, again, general. So still working. It's a long time, but it's working. So we focus on the more responsible, but the others are also responsible and have to face charges.
The gentleman over there, please.
I have a few questions.
One question, please.
Sorry. I'm from Fatah Rahman from Embassy
Speaking
of Sudan.
Speaking to the microphone, please.
From Embassy of Sudan.
Okay.
Here in your first point here, you mentioned the principle of complementarity.
Yeah.
And this is not applied in the case of Sudan. We have in our system, the system of Sudan, the justice system is a well recognized and capable system to serve the justice. So it is not applied in the case of al-Bashir. The other principle of the international principle of sovereignty and of the country and sitting president, the warrant of interest of arrest here for the president is violating this principle. The other, you mentioned here that you want to serve the when there is a serve of the interest of justice.
Mm-hmm.
So do you think this will serve the interest of the justice in Sudan to issue a warrant of arrest for the president, sitting president right now, where there is a peace processes and there is a democratization and many things going on and the system of justice is working? The other thing is that you serve the, you point here that your legal limit. You seem to appear in many events. That is, as if you are doing political campaign, which is it does serve the interest of the justice. Thank you.
Okay. On complementarity, you know, I received the Security Council referral. And for 3 months, I did not open the investigation. I checked if the Sudan was doing national proceedings. And we found they were not. That's why I started investigation. So I checked complementarity. But after that, I keep checking complementarity. And your country invited me to Khartoum. So I visit and interview all the judges, all the prosecutors of Sudan. And basically, they did no case connected with Darfur. And this was confirmed in September 2008 for the African Union, who sent a report from Sudan saying there were 7 cases that you comment on this topic. And the worst, the gravest case was a policeman who killed a person in a demonstration. So nothing to do with the massive campaign we did. So we basically fulfilled absolutely our duty to complementarity, if more. In November 2006, before I presented my case about President Mr. Haroon, I met with your government, and I said to them, look, I will move my case. You have to show me if you are doing cases or not. Because if you do the case, I will not present my case, and I will check if your cases are genuine. Basically, they did not case, so that's why I move. So I fully respect the idea. On immunity, as you know, the judge could be more clear than me, but it's clear jurisprudence and international law saying that there is no immunity for head of state before international courts. So this is our argument, and we represent this. President Bashir has the right to think differently, but he has to go to court, and we'll discuss in court. On interest of peace, it's very interesting because I presented the case of President Bashir in July 2008. In those days, there were no peace process. The peace negotiators resigned in June 2008. Today, there are peace processes. Today, as you know, today in Doha, they are discussing. After I requested, in fact, my request triggered a lot of efforts, contrary to what you say, triggered efforts to achieve peace. African Union appoint with the UN a new negotiator, and Arab League and African Union appoint Qatar Prime Minister as a special in charge of this process. And today in Doha, they are discussing this. So on the contrary, in some way, the request of the court, or my request, triggered discussions. Of course, it's not yet a solution, but at least the negotiations to solve the conflict are in parallel with the ICC decisions. I have no problem if your court are representing Bashir, I have no problem not to talk more about this issue because I have no more need. If you are not arresting President Bashir, I have to explain why it's important to arrest him here.
The gentleman on the aisle there, please.
I'm Welby Lehman from the Treasury Department. I want to ask a question that maybe years ago would have been called the Pinochet problem, and in the future maybe called the Mugabe or Bashir problem or something like that. To what degree should international prosecutors defer to the decision of a country that, being the principal victim of the crimes of its own leader, decides in one way or another not to, so to speak, press charges, but rather reach a grand political bargain that shields the leader from blame in return for a democratic transition?
All the concept in the ICC is never. So we say no national amnesty can oppose again to us. So the law say we should prosecute them. And that's what I'm doing. So this concept is gone. There's no, on the contrary, the principle today, there is no blanket amnesty, in particular for leaders. They cannot be pardoned. So that's the principle who is operating. And this is a new evolution. Imagine, 40 years ago, it was not existing, but now, this is the standard. UN Ban Ki-moon, few months ago, issued a very strong guideline for the UN negotiators on that. So there is no blanket amnesty, no more Pinochet cases.
The gentleman there, please.
My name is Ahmed Abu Zaid from the Embassy of Egypt. I have two questions. In fact, the first one is building on your comment regarding the peace process in Darfur. Should I understand from what you're saying that if there were or there was a credible peace process in Darfur, you would not have proceeded with the President Bashir case or not? The second question is, what do you think about the Mabiki report, the idea of balance between peace and justice and the approach to have a local reconciliation and to apply justice through local reconciliation? Do you accept this notion? Do you think it is acceptable to you? Thank you.
No, maybe I'm not clear. I have to prosecute people. That's my job. That's the law. So I prosecute President Bashir because I have evidence that he's responsible for the crimes committed in Darfur. Of course, at the same time, there had to be negotiation, but President Bashir had to face justice. So you had to find negotiation, you had to negotiate with him or whoever, but he had to face justice. That's it. And all the concept of the Rome Statute is that people learn that appeasing criminals was not working. Was not working the Munich Treaty, not working with Kony, not working with President Bashir. So in Rome, the 136 states who decided that will be no more appeasement for leaders who commit massive crimes. They had to know they will be prosecuted. And that's the rule we're establishing now. Of course, it's difficult because it's like when you decide to stop to smoke, it's a good idea, but the first 2 weeks are complicated. And this happened here, so it's the beginning. But if we can move from this bad equilibrium in which leaders can kill people and nothing happened to an idea in which whoever commit the massive crimes will be prosecuted, that will make a transformation of the world. That's what we are trying to do, move the things, and we're in this process.
The gentleman in the rear row, please.
Thank you. It's Pierre Ghanem, a member of the media from Al Arabiya. A question about the Gaza and the allegations and the Goldstone report. Are you discouraged by any means by the American attitude that this issue should not be brought to the ICC or before you? What is the next move on this?
Okay. In January 2009, so 1 year ago, the Minister of Justice of Palestine came to my office and lodged a declaration accepting jurisdiction for Palestine. He told me that he will come a few months later to explain to give me legal arguments. So a few months later, he came back and explained to me, look, the Rome Statute say a state can accept jurisdiction. We don't like you discussing if Palestine is a state or not because it's a controversial matter and there are different opinions. But we like your understanding. For your role, for the criminal jurisdiction, we have enough capabilities because we have criminal jurisdiction in Palestine. Therefore, we can transfer to you our criminal jurisdiction. That was the argument. And I told him, okay, it's a very interesting argument, but according with the Oslo Treaty, you have jurisdiction for Palestine people, but not against Israeli soldiers, Israeli people. So you cannot transfer to me something you have not, because basically you have no jurisdiction to prosecute Israeli citizens. Then, we'll be back to you. So they come back in October. And the argument is, it's true the Oslo Agreement restricts our jurisdiction, but that proves that we have jurisdiction. Because we have jurisdiction, we restrict it. In the same way that the U.S. is requesting Article 98 agreements, requesting other countries to restrict their own jurisdiction, this is proving that we have inherent jurisdiction here. And that's why we are providing to you, because with the Oslo Agreement, we are unable to exercise jurisdiction, and the Israelis are unwilling to do jurisdiction. That's why you have to do it. So that's the legal argument they are presenting, and they're coming in March again with more arguments because they like to show me some case law they have about normal cases. So that's what we are doing. I receive the complaint, and I let them to give me all the arguments. I receive hundreds of communications, half of them saying I had to reject immediately this request because obviously they are not a state, and the other half of the hundreds of communications we receive saying that I have to immediately accept this request. In both cases, I'm doing my job, letting them to come with the argument. But in the meantime, I told them, okay, I will do my jurisdictional analysis to see, I promise you impartiality and respect for the law, that, and I will listen to you. But in the meantime, where are your national efforts? Because you are telling me that you have jurisdiction in Palestine. Why you're not using your jurisdiction? Why you're not investigating the Palestinian people? Why you're not doing investigation on Israeli soldiers? Because they cannot prosecute Israeli soldiers, but they can investigate Israelis. So we'll see. Arab League is playing a very constructive role here. Arab League, few weeks after Palestine came to my office, they create a fact-finding commission led by Professor Dugar from South Africa, and they produce the first fact-finding report before Richard Gotton report. And now they are working to convince Hamas that they had to also allow to be investigated. So I believe this Palestine move, I feel is very important for the court because Palestine is looking for justice in the court. But also it's changing the dynamic because they are starting to discuss that they cannot use any means. They cannot use crimes to try to solve the problem. And that, in this sense, I think is important. What I will decide, it will depend, we'll see. But that's what I'm doing now. I had to be sure that we had jurisdiction. But in the meantime, I have asking them, what is your homework? Where are your investigations?
We'll have one last question. It'll be from the gentleman in the back, please.
Thank you very much for giving me this opportunity. My name is Peter from Kenya Embassy. I just wanted to get your take on the. We have two Americans who have decided to oppose what you're doing. What is your take on that? Thank you.
I think Kenya is a great example how the court is helping to stabilize the situation. No, because in Kenya they had this violence in the election, the last election, and now they managed very well with the great maturity. But now they are preparing themselves to the 2012 election, and they have to be sure there is no violence. And then we are, in some way, an independent part of the Kenyan justice system, so we are helping them to do justice. The system is we have to request authorization to the judges. The judges can receive any comment, but this comment will be irrelevant. So I believe the case is clear, and the judges will authorize in due time, but they are receiving information. But I believe a Kenya case could be a good example how the idea of the Rome Statute is working and helping countries to move ahead, preventing violence.
Well, thank you so very much, Mr. Moreno-Ocampo. We're most grateful to you.
Thank you very much.
The meeting is closed. Please remember that it has been a meeting that is on the record, and therefore there are no restrictions in referring to it. Good night.
Thank you for watching this Council on Foreign Relations video. For additional audio, video, and transcripts of CFR meetings, as well as expert analysis of international news, please visit us online at cfr.org.